Yeah.
Here is what's at stake at this point. And it's, does Roger have any chance of overtaking?
It's an outside chance at this point.
It's getting smaller.
Getting smaller by the day with Rafa continuing to have the success he had last week and just continuing to play the way he's playing it. I think it's going to take a lot of faltering from Rafa because Roger can only control what he's doing, but he can't control if he plays Rafa in the finals. You know, he's going to pick up points, but not enough to overtake him or pick up that lead. And I think Rafa's got quite the inside track on player of the year at this point.
Yeah, you feel like Roger's going to have to win out. And that means win in Shanghai, most likely win in Paris, maybe win in London as well. And Rafa's going to have to really win no more matches. Yeah. And you just can't see that happening right now. Maybe when it shifts indoors, obviously then Roger, a bigger favorite to win those tournaments, a better indoor player. But if Rafa has a good performance here in Shanghai, I think it's going to be out of reach for Fed.
Yeah, Roger needs to win and get some help. At least, look, these are Masters 1000s. There are two of them left. We're in one right now in Shanghai. So here are the points. If you win it, you get 1,000 points, and Roger's, you know, a little over 2,000 points behind. He really does. He needs some serious help in the first round, really. He needs Rafa to go down.
And we're not seeing that as a possibility the way Rafa was playing last week, although he did face match points to Pui. Pui played excellent against him in the first round. But the way he, you know, then capitalized on that and took the title in Beijing, it just looks like he's playing too solid. And, you know, a lot of times people have worried about his fitness. He plays so many matches, his knees, his back, his wrist, everything that's been injured throughout his career. But he looks healthy right now.
You know, let's hear what Roger actually has to say about chasing Nadal. This is inside the press room.
After he won the US Open, clearly that was not the goal. The goal was always to stay healthy and stay in the chase, possibly, you know. But I know that if I want to finish world number one, I got to win here and World Tour Finals and Paris and Basel, whatever it may be. So it becomes more and more unlikely, which is totally fine because I never entered this season with a goal being the world number one.
Yeah, normally I would say I don't believe it, but he missed the whole fall last year. Like, he missed the whole, like, last third of the season. So it makes sense that really he just wanted to try to stay healthy. He probably is surprised that he's even in this position right now.
I think he's pretty realistic that sometimes ranking sometimes is quantity as well as quality. And Roger was very specific this year in wanting to win more majors. He was able to do that in winning two. He knew he wasn't going to be the player playing every single week. And I think we also have to keep in mind, what is Roger's health like? Because it hasn't been good since the Canadian Open. Had to pull out of since he did not play the U.S. Open 100% healthy with his back. We'll still have to see if his back allows him to play all these tournaments that he's entered to play in as well to make up some ranking points this fall.
Yeah, and I think, like you said, he's realistic, and I think he's very smart with his schedule at this point in his career, 36 years old. He knows he needs to take some time off, whether it's his back. Last year it was his knee, and he's seen the success he had this year after taking 6 months off with his knee injury last year. So I think he shouldn't be afraid to, if his back is still bothering him. He knows that if he shuts it down for a couple months, he can come back and still be the type of player that can win Grand Slams. And I think that's his main goal at this point, at this stage in his career, that he's fighting for his legacy more than for ranking points or just chasing smaller titles.
Well, that's the thing. He's got to keep winning Grand Slams because Djokovic and Nadal are still going. Mm-hmm. We're going to see Djokovic again, I'm sure, at the beginning of 2018. Here's a look at Monday's movers. The rankings come out on Mondays. Start with the men. And the interesting thing to me here, we highlight Rublev, but it's Nick Kyrgios. He gets to the finals in Beijing, but he still falls three ranking slots.
Always interesting for fans to notice when that kind of thing happens. It's just because of what they're defending. It's the rolling schedule for a rolling year based on 52 weeks prior. And he won it last year, so this time he loses in the finals and drops a few spots. Highlighting Andrei Rublev, he's had such an amazing year, breakout year for him, only 19 years old. And jumping from 156 all the way up to 35 in the world it's a huge effort. And as you get higher, it gets tougher and tougher every spot you're getting higher.
And can I just say, Diego Schwartzman is now at a career-high 26.
Amazing.
He's 5'7" tall, which is the perfect height, if you ask me, because I'm 5'7". But really, how much of a disadvantage is that for a guy at that height on tour? To play, and how impressive is it that he's playing as well as he is?
It's incredible. It's incredible at that size because I'm 6'1", and I felt like I was at a disadvantage by the end of my career seeing all these guys I'm playing against. They're 6'5", 6'6", guys like Isner, 6'10", and they're able to serve against a guy 5'7", it's such a huge disadvantage when you got a guy like Isner serving it and kicking it almost over his head. He has to hit so many balls, and especially, you know, those guys have to be so strong to get balls up over their shoulder and able to still come through it with some power. He neutralized it with amazing speed, and he's able to get, you know, kind of first strike tennis as well. So he's really impressive with the way he does it, but it's a huge disadvantage to not have that kind of reach and not have that kind of ability on your serve.
I'll say this from experience. We don't know any different. I wish I knew what it was like to be tough.
How about Monfils? We didn't even mention him. Now, outside the top 40, he was just in the top 10 last year. Really tough year for him. A lot of injuries, but kind of shocking to see his name and that number right next to it.
Yeah, he's one of those guys that can be extremely dangerous if he's healthy. Yeah. When he's in a draw now, he won't be seated at many events. But when he's healthy, he can play at that top 10 level like he showed us last year.
All right, let's move it on to the women's side. The WTA Monday Movers, and congratulations one more time to Simona Halep, the 25th all-time number one in the WTA rankings. But it's really Caroline Garcia who might be the hottest player on tour right now.
And that is a tough jump to make from 15 into the top 10, and she did it with back-to-back wins in Wuhan and then Beijing, the premier mandatory for the women. Jo Konta with a tough fall there from 7 to 10. She got to the final last year in Beijing. This year, lost in the first round, lost some ranking points there. Radwanska, she drops out again, but Maria now back into the top 100. That will ensure her in the main draw of the the Australian Open. No more talk about wild cards in the majors for Maria.
And Radwanska is going to drop out of the top 20 for the first time since 2007 coming up. But Caroline Garcia, Johanna Konta are, they're in a death match right now.
Neck and neck.
For that final spot in the year-end finals for the women. Who's got the edge and why?
Well, it's so interesting that Garcia, out of nowhere, was able to leapfrog Konta. She had to win both tournaments in China. She was able to do that. And now she's 185 points ahead for that eighth spot in Singapore. Konta is entered in the tournament in Moscow. She has to reach the final to be able to pass Garcia. Garcia doesn't play again. The tournament in Moscow said they were not going to give Caroline Garcia a wild card, so now she's debating if she should play a smaller event in Luxembourg. So they're kind of, I think they're all trying to figure out, how do we make it in Singapore? That is the number one goal. It'll be interesting to see how this plays out next week on tour. Neither player playing this week in the three WTA tournaments that are going on.
You got to bring in like an actuary. Crunch the numbers and try to figure it all out at this time of the year. But you've been in that position. You know what it's like to be on the precipice, right?
I remember I did it about 3 years in a row. I think the year I made it in 2006, it was by one match. I think Marin Cilic had to beat Nikolai Davydenko, Davydenko had to beat Cilic. That was big for me. And then the next year I had to beat Tsonga and I lost. And then the year after, I forget what happened, but it came down to one match 3 years in a row. And it's just, you're figuring out those last couple of events, you've got three or four people vying for it, and you're figuring out where they are in the draw, who they can beat. And if you win this match, and it's just, it's better to not even think about it. I couldn't do that. I had too much free time on my hands. This was before Netflix and before Twitter. I didn't have other things to think about, so I was thinking too much about the rankings.
No, a lot of players wish they had such problems, that they were that close to getting into the year-end finals. We'll be right back.